Welcome to Unit 3, Jainism of the second book, Religions of Indian Origin from BPY 004, Religions of the World. So Unit 3, Jainism, Objectives. In this unit, we are going to cover the key features of a religion that has come down to us right from the pre-Aryan antiquity. It has given the world some unique doctrines in philosophy. Though we may not be able to make a detailed analysis of those philosophical doctrines here, we will see their impact on religious views. First, we will try to have an overview of its historical development. Next, we will identify its basic scriptures and beliefs. Thirdly, we will try to understand the Jain idea of salvation and finally learn the ethical teachings of this ancient religion and still practiced by a vibrant minority. By the end of this unit, you should be able to have an overall glance at the long history of Jainism, identify the basic scriptures and beliefs of Jainism, understand the Jain path to liberation, and appreciate Jain teachings on morality. So unit 3.0 objective ho gaya. 3.1 introduction. Jainism is one of the oldest religions of the world, originating on the Indian soil. Jainism has a rich history, not only because of its continuity of existence for over 2500 years in India, but also because of its unique contributions to Indian philosophy, logic, mathematics, art, astronomy, and literature. Its special emphasis on ethical purity, religious tolerance, spiritual contentment, ecological protection is all of the topical relevance to today's society all over the world. Like Buddhism, Jainism also arose in opposition to the sacrificial Vedic religion and the domination of the high caste. It does not advocate belief in God or gods to whom we need to pray, nor does it accept the intercessory role of priestly class in society. It has empowered its followers to be spiritually self-reliant, with its key idea, everyone is maker of one's own destiny. That is why it is fitted called Jaina Dharma. So the word Jaina derived from the root word meaning to conquer. It was established by a great hero who was himself a conqueror of self to make his followers also to be spiritual conquerors. 3.2, a historical overview. Our attempt in this section is just to have a glance at the origin and development of the Jain religion. After stating that the traditional claim about its origin, we will devote more time to the historical beginnings from Mahavira. Then we will trace its development in the formation of schisms, and finally cast a quick glance at present day situation too. Now, origin from antiquity. The Jains consider their religion to be eternal and imperishable. The darkness of error may develop the truth periodically, but the Tirthankaras will appear again and again and make it blossom in youthful beauty like the spring. Tirthankara literally means a bridge maker. Religiously, Tirtha is the holy bridge for people to cross the ocean of the bondage of birth, misery, death, samsara. Jains recognize 24 Tirthankaras who have enlivened the faith periodically. The first Tirthankara was Rishabha. The last of these was Mahavira. The Jains know their names and can narrate many details from their life. But their narratives about them, all except the last two, Parshava and Mahavira, are legendary and mythological. Nevertheless, Mahavira was a historical personality as corroborated by other sources as well. The Jaina Dharma that has come to us in the one that was expounded by Mahavira only. The historical origin from Mahavira. Vardhamana 599 to 527 BCE, was the second son of the chieftain of a politically powerful clan in Magad, the present Bihar. His mother was a sister of the local ruler too. Obviously, this upbringing was also royal. He was also married to a beautiful lady, Yashodha, had a daughter from her. When he was 28 years old, his parents died of self-imposed starvation as they were already believing devotees of Parshava, the 23rd Tirthangara, who had lived during the 9th century BCE. Maybe that it had such an impact on the prince that he wanted to leave his home in pursuance of a life of ecstasy. But he was dissuaded by the family members. But he was keen on his search that finally, after 2 years, he got the consent of his elder brother, renounced the family life and joined the ascetic order of Nirganthas, free of bonds, founded by the teacher Parshava himself, Mahavira the seeker. After some time, Mahavir felt that the precepts of Nigranthas were not strict enough. So he left them and went on as a wanderer without shelter to the vagaries of weather. He exposed himself to the attacks by insects, injuries and abuse of man, eating nothing but what was offered to him by others, often observing long fasts. He even realized the necessity of renouncing all attachments and possessions, including the only garment he wore, after such a long time of 12 years. Finally, when he achieved the state of aminiscence or kevala, literally aloneness, he was called Mahavira, the great hero. Jina, victor, one who had conquered the self as well as the world. And Arhat, a venerable person. Mahavira's mission. Immediately after this attainment, Mahavira realized the duty to proclaim his path of liberation to all creatures and revive Pasharva's teachings. Now he also kept up traveling on bare feet, unclothed, and begging for food. He preached to all Aryans, barbarians, men and women, and even to the creatures like frogs. He attracted people from all walks of life, rich and poor, kings and commoners, men and women, prince and priests, caste people as well as untouchables. Many of his followers also became renouncers, abandoning worldly pleasures and being convinced that renunciation was the way to conquer all passions. He organized his followers into a fourfold orders, two for monastic life and two for lay people. The order of sadhu, monk, and the order of sadhvi, nuns. They practice self-control and have given up all desires and earthly possessions to become the spiritual practitioner and teachers. They follow strictly five Mahavratas. You will see in detail in the section 3.5. The order of the Shravak, layman, and the order of Shravika, lay women. They are not required to renounce the world but are expected to discharge household duties by honest means and live a progressive pure life. They need to follow 12 vows of lay people. According to tradition, Mahavira won over 14,000 monks and 36,000 nuns, lakhs of laymen and laywomen as his followers. Now that he has thus founded the four Tirthas, he came to be called the 24th Tirthangara, literally bridge maker. Mahavira is remembered not so much as the founder of a new religion as the renewer or reviver of Jainism. He was a great and powerful thinker too. He had taken a keen interest in all the problems of life at his time. The answers he gave were systematic and yet analytically interpreting even the minutest detail of the issues. His spiritual power and moral greatness was recognized by his contemporaries belonging to other religions. Finally, at the age of 72, he died of self-imposed starvation. This gave him still another title, Siddha, the one who has acquired pure consciousness. As any other Siddha, he is living on top of the cosmos in a state of perfect knowledge, perfect vision, complete power and bliss. It is this night of his salvation that people begin to celebrate as the festival of lights, Deepavali, in his honor. rise of the sects. In a few centuries after Mahavira's Nirvana, the Jain community, Sangha, grew more and more complex. One section of the Sangha was too ascetic-minded and puritanistic in their approach. Another section was liberal. The disagreement between the two groups over largely monastic practices led to schism in Jainism. Division that began around the 2nd century BCE and was finalized in the formation of two sects in the 1st century. Later many points of disagreements. For example, the questions regarding the life story of Mahavira, canon of scriptures, the position of women, etc. contributed to schism. Thus, these arose two branches of Jainism. So, the first branch of Jainism is Digambaras, literally the sky-clad. So, Digambaras maintain that monks must be naked because nakedness is a proof of conquest of sin. Tirthankars should be represented naked without ornaments. Mahavira never married. So that the Digambaras, they say. And they also say that only males can achieve enlightenment. Consequently, women do not become naked ascetics. They cannot obtain moksha. And then they have Shvetambaras, literally the white clad. Opposed to all claims mentioned above, they upheld wearing of simple white garment. Probably the religional factors must have contributed to the division. The Digambaras were principal force of culture in the south and in central India, enjoying the royal patronage from the local kings. The Digambaras contributed to the development of vernacular language in these regions. But the Shvetambaras played much the same role in the north and the west of India. Later developments. By 11th and 12th century CE, the Digambaras had to retreat to the north. Owing to the disfavor they incurred from the local kings, which itself on account of the spread of Hindu Bhakti movement. By 16th century, Jainism had reached the current geographical status, and from now on it has witnessed various reform movements within. From among the Shvetambaras, a reformist sect arose about 15th century by the name Sathankvasi sect, criticizing image worship and temple cult because it was not even mentioned once in the scriptures. On the contrary, Lonkasa pointed out that practice was not lawful. So there arose after him Lonkasa sect. From the Lonka Jains, still another reformer arose, Viraji of Suraj. He was critical of the sadhus that they were leading less austere life. In the 16th century, there arose two sects from among the Digambaras too, as against the Vishvampanthis or Vispanthis, who install images of gods like Bhairava in their temples, cover idols with saffron clothes, offer flowers, sweets and wave lights, etc. The Therapanthis did not accept any of these. The present day situation. Many sects have arisen among Jains or on account of minor differences, and they all agree on the main doctrines of the Tirthankaras. Today, the Jains remain a religious minority constituting 3.2 million of Indian population. Yet, they are powerful in retaining their identity. They are the oldest practicing minority of indigenous religion originating in ancient India. They avoid farming for fear of inflicting violence accidentally to insects. They prefer to be mainly jewelers, merchants, moneylenders and industrialists. As such, they live in urban centers in the modern states of Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh and Karnataka. As merchants and business people, they are known for their honesty. Even though the Jains are a wealthy community, they seek out the humanitarian causes to support them and relieve suffering. They are particularly renowned for operating centers dedicated to maintaining abused and sick animals. Their key principles like Ahimsa had such an impact on Mahatma Gandhi's policy development regarding the use of non-violent resistance in his liberation movements. Check your progress. How did Vardhaman get the titles of Jina, Mahavira and Tirthankara? Number two, state the main divisions of Jainism. Sacred scriptures of Jainism. It may be convenient to divide the Jaina scriptures into two main groups, the early Prakritic scriptures, later Sanskrit scriptures. Mahavira's teachings were first orally transmitted to people. His disciples, Gandharas, wrote them down first in the text form of 14 Purvas, earlier works, and then in 12 Angas, parts, in 12 Angas. They were faithfully preserved by the leaders of the community among the first followers. However, there arose some questions about parts of this canon. Hence, a council was called around 300 BCE in Pataliputra to put together the canon anew. There, they found out that the 12th Anga containing the Purvas was not authentic. Bhadra Bahu, who knew this completely, could not attend the council because he was at that time penitential view vow of 12 years in Nepal. Therefore, Sthul Bhadra was instructed to go there along with many other monks and learn the Purvas from him. And the mission was successful too. However, in the process of transmission for 7 generations of teachers after Sthul Bhadra, the knowledge of the 10 Purvas was completely lost. Canon of the Shvetambras. It was in the context that Shvetambras convened a council at Vallabhi in Gujarat in the 5th CE to edit and preserve whatever remained as holy books. The earliest portions of Jain scriptures belong to the period between 400 BCE and 200 CE. They are all in Prakritic or Ardha Magdhi language. This Shvetambra canon contains 45 books. They consist of 11 Angas, 12 Upangas, supplementary portions, 10 Parikarnas, scattered pieces on variety of topics, 4 Mool Sutras, 6 Sheda Sutras, sanction on discipline, and 2 Sutras on knowledge. They are indeed the source books of Jaina ethics, yoga, religion, philosophy, and mythology. Sanskrit canon of the Digambras. While not disrupting with the dogmatic content of Shvetambra canon, the Digambras held that the language and form of Shvetambra canon was not authentic. On the contrary, they were in possession of 2 very old Prakritic texts that predate the compilation of Shvetambra canon. With those 2 ancient texts, the Digambras tried to supplement them with commentaries and other series of works and made a claim that they were authoritative accounts of the Jain doctrine. They called their canons as Anuyoga, expositions. This category of scriptures was written in Sanskrit largely from 700 to 900 CE. They take the position of the old lost canon. They are distinguished into 4 groups and named them as 4 Vedas. The first Veda deals with history. Second Veda deals with the cosmography. The third Veda with philosophy. The last Veda deals with ethics and rituals. An important feature of this canon is that much of it deals with the lay community, and it includes writings that give a Jaina the view of a world prehistory and of the origins of human institutions and everyday religious activity. This shows that a major development took place regarding the systemization of lay life. 3.4. Basic beliefs of Jainism. As regards the basic teachings of Jaina, it may be convenient to present them in the form of new propositions. We take care to enumerate only those basic teachings which are of general nature. Whatever is pertinent to the path of liberation and ethics will be treated in their respective sections below. Oneness of all the scriptures. The orthodox position of the Jain tradition is that holy scriptures from the time of Tirthankaras should essentially agree with one another. Only names are supposed to vary, like the teachings of early Tirthankaras. Mahavira's teachings also have been recorded in the Jain works. Though the different canons have emerged, yet the basic beliefs about Mahavira are not questioned. No belief in God. Jainism is a non-theistic religion. It does not believe in a creator or God. For it upholds that the reality of the universe is explainable by the six substances. Jiva, that is consciousness, matter, space, motion ether, resting ether, time. They are all eternal, having neither beginning nor end with respect to time. According, there is no need of God to create or manage the affairs of the universe. Universe is running on its own accord and by its own cosmic laws. Belief in karma. Central to Jainism is the belief in reincarnation and karma, merit and demerit. The self is polluted by karmic particles, bits of materials generated by a person's actions that attach to the soul and consequently bind the soul to material bodies through many births. There are eight kinds of karma. The first four karmas are called gati karmas because they obscure the natural qualities of the soul. The last four karmas are known as agati karma because they are related to the body of the soul. If one successfully destroys all the eight karmas and when karmic particles are wiped from the self, then one attains release from the bondage. When it gets into enlightenment, the soul no longer faces rebirth. Jain gods, in the path of spiritual progress, if one destroys all the eight karmas, then one is totally free. There is no body, no birth and death cycle, no feeling of pleasure and pain or joy and sorrow. One attains such liberation that one is pure soul. Now with its omnipotence, perfect vision, and everlasting blissful condition, one is now a Siddha at the top of Lokakas known as Moksha. All Siddhas possess the same quality of soul and their attributes are same. However, they still maintain their unique identity. But if a person has destroyed only four Gati Karmas, one has regained the original attributes of one's soul, omniscience, omnipotence, vision, power and bliss, but still one is a human being. One preaches the religion and remains in the state of blissful condition for the rest of one's life. One remains Jinnah, one who has conquered one's inner enemies, passions like anger, greed, passion, hatred, ego. Nirganthas means one who has gotten rid of all attachments. So one is called Arihanta, one has attained Keval Janana. Now there are two kinds of Arihantas. If an Arihanta has established order of monks and nuns, then one is called Tirthankara. If an Arihanta does not establish the religious order, one remains just a Kevali. But one is in the state of perfect blissful condition for the rest of one's life after attaining Keval Janma. Now all Arihants, Tirthankaras and ordinary Kevalis and Siddhas are considered gods of Jain religion. So Jaina prayer. Jainas do not ask for any favors or material benefits from their gods. The Tirthankaras or from monks and nuns. They do not pray to a specific Tirthankara or monk by name. By saluting them, Jains receive the inspiration from the five benevolent for the right path of true happiness and total freedom from the misery of life. So the Navkara... Just a moment. Okay, by saluting them, Jains receive the inspiration from the five benevolent for the right path of true happiness and total freedom from the misery of life. So the Namaskar Mantra is universal prayer which the Jains are supposed to say every day, bowing their heads and when they start good work and events. The prayer is Namo Arihantam. I bow to the Arihantas, that ever perfect spiritual victors. Namo Siddhanam. I bow to the Siddhas, the liberated souls. Namo Ayarinam. I bow to the Acharyas, the leaders of the Jain order. Namo Ujvenam. I bow to Upadhyas, the learned preceptors. Namo lo sava sahunam. I bow to all saints and sages everywhere in the world. Eso panch namukaro. These five obeisances, sava pavap pasanum, erase all sins. Mangalachala savesin, amongst all that is auspicious. Padmam havai mangalam. This is the foremost. The unique doctrine of Anekanta Veda. It says that reality can be viewed from many. Aneka standpoints anta. At least seven standpoints can be used to describe a thing. And all can be equally true. This is truly a Catholic outlook towards life. It is indeed an intellectual. Non-violence implies rest to for other views. The last line says, it is truly a Catholic outlook towards life. It is indeed an intellectual. Non-violence implies respect for other views. It contributes to the tolerance of the contrary opinions among different schools of thought. It has a special relevance of for a multi-religious society like ours. Check your progress. Number one, state the central belief of the Jaina religion. Number two, how did Jainism succeed in denying the belief in God as a creator, protector? What is the alternative? Jain idea of human destiny. 3.5. As a religious reformer, Mahavir was critical of the Vedas and the Brahmins. He saw no relevance of the priestly class and their sacrificial rites. The Jain religion is unique in this that it eradicates from human intellect the conception of God as a creator, protector and destroyer, and thus denouncing the worship of gods and goddesses as a means of salvation. As an alternative to what he denounced, Mahavira made religion simple and natural, free from elaborate ritual complexities. He insisted upon the popular impulse towards internal beauty and harmony of the soul. He expounded the features of the soul in its pristine purity. Mahavira has said, a living body is not merely an integration of limbs and flesh, but it is the abode of the soul, which potentially has perfect perception. Ananta darshana, perfect knowledge. Ananta janana, perfect power. Ananta virya, and perfect bliss. Ananta sukha. In contrast, he made a thorough analysis of the pitiable conditions of the empirical self. He thereby established the need to fight passions and bodily senses to purify the soul and gain omniscience or attain the total freedom from the cycle of birth, life, pain, misery and death. The Jain goal known as Kevala Jana, the idea of supremacy of human and possibly of attaining perfect power, knowledge, bliss. This is the sum and substance of Jain's idea of human destiny. The first step in the process of self-realization is to discard superstitious beliefs and to adopt a rational attitude in life. Jainism lays down a definitive course of practical moral discipline. Contemplation of the highest truth, the reorientation of life in life light of these for attaining ultimate reality or truth. The whole account of the Jain path to liberation may be summed up by three terms which are called Ratnatraya, three jewels in Jaina literature. So the first one of them is right perception, Samyak Darshana. Awareness of true nature of every substance of the universe, one's own self, religious goal and the path. From the practical point of view, it means to have a total faith in preaching of Tirthankaras and their scriptures known as Agams. Number two is right knowledge, Samayak Jana. Along with the six universal substance entities and nine tattvas, two specific doctrines of Anekanta Veda, non-absolutism, call for an attitude of openness. Syadvada points out limitations of knowledge and allows no room for assertions. Right conduct. Number three, right conduct. Samayak charitra. Proper action and proper conduct with a view to free oneself from attainment, raga and aversion, devasya, and attain the state of perfect ecumenity. For practical purposes, one has to follow ethical codes, rules and disciplines. The three jewels, if cultivated together, will ensure liberation. But if each of these three is practiced in isolation from the other two, it will cause conflict or tensions. Individually, they are complete and insufficient because they are mutually dependent with one another. Right faith and right knowledge are required for right conduct. Proper conduct through vows upkeeps proper perception and knowledge. Vows are to be undertaken with a full knowledge of their nature and a determination to carry them through. Last page, Jain Ethics 3.6. A strict code of conduct is prescribed in Jainism, not so much for the sake of morality as the path of liberation. In fact, Jainism views religion merely as a science of ethical practice. It conceives the human body as a chariot on which the soul rides towards the liberation. The conduct of the present life should be aimed at attaining total freedom from which there is no return to the birth and death cycle. Every soul can attend godhood, that is supreme spiritual individuality, by realizing its intrinsic purity and perfection. The overall cast of Jaina's path to liberation is the three jewels, Ratna Triya, which you have seen just in the foregoing section. Right knowledge, right intuition and right conduct. Now the effulgence of the last mentioned jewel consists in the five great vows, or popularly called Mahapanchavrata. Here the Sanskrit word vrata is derived from vri, meaning to select or choose. Technically, it means choosing the right course of conduct. Number two, exercising the judgment to see what is the right course out of several possible courses. And number three, the effort of will implied. They are the following: non-violence, truthfulness and non-stealing. Ahimsa, Satya and Astya. Chastity, Brahmacharya, not to indulge in sensual pleasure, non-possession, non-attachment, complete detachment from people, places and material things. So the first one is non-violence, ahimsa. Non-violence is based on love and kindness of all living beings. Non-violence in Jainism is not a negative virtue. It is based upon the positive quality of universal love and compassion. According to Jainism, all living beings, irrespective of their size, shape or different spiritual developments, are equal. No living being has the right to harm, injure or kill any other living being, including animals, insects and plants. Every living being has a right to exist, and it is necessary to live with every other living being in perfect harmony and peace. Truth. Anger, greed, fear, jokes, etc. are the breeding grounds of untruth. To speak the truth requires moral courage. Only those who have conquered greed, fear, anger, jealousy, ego, frivolity, etc. can speak of the truth. Jainism insists that one should not only refrain from falsehood, but should always speak the truth, which should be wholesome and pleasant. One should remain silent if the truth causes pain, hurt, anger or death of any living being. Non-stealing. Stealing consists of taking another's property without consent or by unjust or immoral methods. Further, one should not take anything which does not belong to oneself. It does not entitle one to take away a thing which may be lying unattended or unclaimed. One should observe this vow very strictly and should not touch even a worthless thing which does not belong to oneself. Now, celibacy or chastity, brahmacharya. Total abstinence from sensual pleasure is called celibacy. Sensual pleasure is an infatuating force which sets aside all virtues and reasons at the time of indulgence. This vow of controlling sensuality is very difficult to observe in its subtle form. One may refrain from physical indulgence, but may still think of the pleasures of sensualism, which is prohibited in Jainism. Non-attachment, non-possession. Jainism believes that the more worldly wealth a person possesses, the more one is likely to commit sin to acquire the possession. And in a long run, one may be more unhappy. The worldly wealth creates attachments which will continuously result in greed, jealousy, selfishness, ego, hatred, violence, etc. Lord Mahavir has said that wants and desires have no end, and only the sky is the limit for them. Attachments to worldly objects result in the bondage to the cycle of birth and death. Therefore, one who desires of spiritual liberation should withdraw from all attachments to pleasing objects of all the five senses. Check your progress. Explain the importance of morality in Jain Dharma. Elucidate the Mahabharata. Let us sum up 3.7. Jainism is one of the oldest religions that originated in India. Jains believe that every soul is divine, has the potential to achieve enlightenment or moksha. Any soul which has conquered its own inner enemies and achieved the state of supreme being is called Jinna, conqueror or victor. Jainism is the path to achieve this state. Jainism is often referred to as Jain Dharma or Sharman Dharma or the religion of Nirangatha or religion of Vartyas by ancient texts. It was revived by a lineage of 24 enlightened ascetics called Tirthankaras, culminating with the Parsavas, 9th century BCE, and Mahavira, 6th century before Christ era. In the modern world, it is small but influential religious minority with as many as 4 million followers in India, and successful growing immigrant communities in North America, Western Europe, and Far East, Australia, and elsewhere. Jains have sustained the ancient Sharman or ascetic religion and have significantly influenced other religions, ethical, political, and economic spheres in India. They have an ancient tradition of scholarship and have the highest degree of literacy in India. Jain libraries are the oldest in the country. Keyword Shism. Shism means a division or a split. Originally, it was used to refer the Shism in Christianity, such as the East-West Shism, the split between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church in the 11th century. Incarnation and reincarnation. Incarnation, which literally means embodied in flesh, refers to the conception and birth of a sentient creature, generally a human, as in the case of Jesus Christ, who is the material manifestation of being of our force, whose original nature is immaterial or divine. Reincarnation means to be made flesh again, to reborn. It is a doctrine or metaphysical belief that some essential part of living being, in some variations only, human beings, survives death to be reborn in new body. Thank you so much for your time.